What do you think of the newspaper guild as an influence in journalism?
I think it's been I think the idea of the newspaper guild is good, but that the influence of the guild has been bad, almost unqualifiedly bad, for the reason that it got into the hands of the wrong men, beginning with the first of them, Hayward Prune. As I said some time ago, I've been sold down the river 3 times in my life, papers sold or busted under me. It happened that every time, having been born lucky, it was a good thing for me. But I saw and knew intimately many men for whom it was a dreadfully tragic thing. And I always believed that the men on a newspaper, or any group of men, ought to have some machinery for compensating their individual impotence. I lived through the time when a old-time ice wagon driver city editor might come down in the morning with a hangover and fire a man simply because he was in bad humor. That is not theory. I've seen it done. I was a city editor and fired men, but I never did it for that reason. But I probably did it for reasons that were just as irrational. I didn't like the man. I believe that if a man works for any institution or industry for a given time, for a reasonable time, so that he's settled down into his job, he requires a kind of vested interest in his job. And it ought to be impossible to fire him wantonly and without compensation. All that I'm in favor of. I think that the man as a whole, as a group, can always bargain with the administration better than men alone. I'm in favor of that. But when the guild began to develop, it turned out very quickly that the guild was a conspiracy of the more incompetent and useless men on newspapers, not only against the boss, but also against the good men. That, like any other labor union, it began to be dominated by the selling platers. And it hence made its fight along lines that were, to me, silly. For instance, its fight to greatly exaggerate and increase the wages of office boys and of all of the third-rate people that hang around the edges of a newspaper staff. When I negotiated with the guild, as you may remember, I tried hard to separate the actual newspaper men from all these auxiliaries. I don't care. I think the auxiliaries ought to be represented. But they ought not dominate the guild. The newspaper men ought to speak for themselves. I never, as a negotiator for the Sun, objected to any reasonable demand made by the men. I don't know whether you remember that negotiation.
I do.
But I was always in favor of what the men, the actual good men, wanted, including some things that were expensive to the paper or seemed to me a little bit irrational. But nevertheless, I think a man is entitled to be a little irrational about himself. But when they began taking in girls who take want ads, telephone operators, and all such people, I washed my hands of it. I don't believe that's a newspaper guild anymore. It's just simply a gang of fourth-rate employees with the newspaper men as unwilling perfumers. I think the guild would be very well advised if it sloughed off all of those auxiliaries and went back to being a newspaper guild. It would then be dignified. The bosses would lose 3/4 of their arguments against it. And the higher administration on newspapers would be more friendly. Remember, the higher men on newspapers are nearly all men who have been active newspaper men. There are very few who it happened. I don't know anybody on the Sun papers in any executive position who hasn't been through the mill. Do you?
No, I don't.
A man that hadn't been through the mill would be a rather useless man. He'd never be chosen for his job on grounds of merit, be some extraneous thing. But the newspaper guild began making demands, particularly on the weaker papers. They seemed to delight in the fact that They had a, when they got hold of a weak proprietor who simply was helpless. They had strikes. They tried to ruin the man. And in the end, they did ruin a good many of them. And it's a curious thing that all of the proprietors who were most friendly to him at the start were the men that they picked on for a special persecution. For example, Davy Stern, Philadelphia, and that fellow in St. Petersburg, Florida, who I don't know him at all. But he reached a point where he could not operate his paper under the demands being made. And he had two choices. One was to fold his paper, sell it to somebody, or sell it to somebody, and the other choice was to fight him. He decided to fight him. He threw out all guilds and unions, although he was a sincere friend of unionism. He found there were a lot of old printers down in Florida who didn't, having tried for a while being retired, they didn't like it. They wanted to get back in the office and get a little ink on them. And he soon had a composing room staff. He found that there were many newspaper men who didn't like the Guild, but who did like working in Florida. Some of them came to see me when I was down there last winter. And they went down. He pays them fairly reasonable wages. And he's got his whole plant run by non-union people, and he's doing very well. And many other proprietors around the country are following suit. And I believe that some big city will make the break soon, and then you will see chaos. The unions will lose all they have gained by long years of work, particularly the typographic union, which was a very high-toned union, as you remember, run by men of intelligence, has lately got in the hands of extreme radicals whose main animating idea seems to be that the boss is a scoundrel, regardless of whether he is or not. That's a kind of a formal assumption that they make. And they're going to make it until someday the boss gets tired of it and throws them all out and keeps them out. There are papers at this minute that have no union organization whatever. One is one of the most prosperous papers in America, the Philadelphia Bulletin. Nobody in the Bulletin has to join a union. They have no prejudice against the union man. He can belong to the union all he pleases. He can work in the paper. They pay good wages, always a little above the union scale. That is up now, always a little above. I think the union scales in some crafts are getting so preposterous that there'll come a time soon when newspaper proprietors will simply refuse to pay them.